Really, when you think about it, it's clean versus unclean. And the text we see is going to be in Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 29. But first, let us pray. Our blessed Heavenly Father, we are so thankful, Father, that you have given us your word, you have given us your love, you have given us so many blessings. And Father, we know that everything that you've given us, Father, has been totally unconditional. But you have given us training, Father, that will help us not only in this world that we live in, but also in our spiritual lives as well. And Father, we thank you for that. Father, we ask that you bless everyone that's here today. Bless them with a wonderful, peaceful, joyous day, Father, where they can enjoy time with both their church family and their physical families. Keep us all safe. Father, these things we pray and thank you for in Christ Jesus' most holy name. Amen. When we look at our text today, we're going to be looking at the book of Matthew, chapter 7. And we want to start out by reading the first two verses of that text. The Bible reads at chapter 7, verses 1 and 2, "Judge not, that you be not judged. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you." As we look at this text here, what we find is that whatever severity with which we judge someone else, God would judge us as well with that same severity. We need to know that we cannot, even if we wanted to, judge someone else. Jesus is indeed the final judge. And each person, each one of us, will stand before Jesus on the final day of judgment. The text wants us to understand that we are not to condemn someone else, for instance, for smoking, if we are smoking. We are not to condemn someone else for overeating if we are overeating. What God wants us to do is examine ourselves and get forgiveness for our own actions, for our own trespasses, for our own sins. He wants us to do that before we start pointing a finger at someone else. God expects us to consider in ourselves if someone is truly of God, though. He does want that. He wants us to do that rather than just blindly following them down the path of unrighteousness. But at the same time, he wants us to understand that even though we're doing this, we are not in a position to determine whether or not someone is saved. He wants us to know that that is between that person and God. And anything that we're offering is just our opinion. And I remember Mike saying that himself, people come forward asking to be baptized. We do ask questions, but we don't try to determine whether or not their heart is right. That's God's job. That's Christ Jesus' job. The Bible says, if we know one of our brothers is sinning, we're supposed to go talk to him. The Bible says, if that person doesn't want to listen, we're supposed to take a witness. Then the Bible says, if that person still refuses to listen, we are supposed to discontinue fellowship with that person. And with all of that done, if it does happen, whether God forgives or not, it's not our business. The only judgment that is allowed is whether we should fellowship with that person or not. Because again, Jesus is the final judge. I take you back to our text. We look at verses 3 through 5. The Bible reads, "Why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye,' when there is the log in your own eye? You hypocrite. First, take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye." In the book of John, at chapter 8, verses 3 through 11, there is a lesson there that comes clearly in mind when we look at all of this. What we find there is a group of righteous, a group of religious people They've caught this woman, according to the text, in the very act of adultery. And it's interesting, and we've probably talked about this before, how they caught her in the very act, but only the woman was brought to be stoned. Jesus told them that he who is without sin, let them cast the first stone. And then we're told that Jesus leaned down and started to write in the sand. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us what Jesus wrote, but it would be fair to say he possibly wrote about the sins of the people who had brought the lady before him. We find that when Jesus finished writing and looked up, the woman was standing there, unstoned. And Jesus told the woman that he did not condemn her either, to go and sin no more. John 8, verses 3 through 11, is the most vivid example of what we just read in Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 5. Whether we are a preacher, whether we are an elder, whether we are a deacon, or members of the flock, if we are proclaiming Christianity, we need to live clean lives. And by clean lives, what I'm saying is this right here. We need to live our lives in such a way that we are above the appearance of evil. And then through love and concern, we can encourage others to clean up their lives, not in a spirit of condemnation, but in a spirit of love. We go back to our text at verse 6. The Bible reads, "Do not give dogs what is holy, and do not throw your pearls before pigs, lest they trample them on the foot and turn to attack you." These dogs and pigs that's being mentioned here, in a sense, they are people of low moral, low character. That's what it's all about here. These people have no intention of coming to Christ Jesus. So it is as if the lesson to be learned here is saying this right here. When there is no hope of regeneration, when there is no hope of bringing a person to Christ, then leave them to their own mire. Leave them to their own sin. Don't get in the mud hole with them. Don't get in the pigsty with them and let them destroy you. Don't get down there and let them destroy your spiritual treasures. Those treasures that you or that we have obtained from God. What it's telling us is don't stay around and listen to them blaspheme your Savior. It's telling us don't wallow in the sin or don't wallow in the mud with them. Because you see, it's not going to get them clean. It's only going to get us dirty. It kind of reminds me of something I witnessed when I was preaching in Nokiski, where the brother was going to the bar all the time with this guy. And I asked him, I said, "How often have you invited him to come to services with you?" He said, "Quite a bit." I said, "How often does he come?" He said, "Once." "How often does he invite you to go to the bar?" No response. "How often do you go?" No response. But then he said, "But I know if I go there with him, I can talk about Jesus, I can convert him." Well, folks, you probably don't know this about me, but back when I was about 23 years old, before I got married, I was a bartender. And one thing about bartenders is just like on the TV show Cheers, one thing about bartenders, they hear all sorts of, when people first come in, semi-intellectual conversations taking place. And after they've been there for a while, there's no intellect whatsoever. So I'm listening to this and saying, you sitting at this bar with this person, you may be talking Jesus, but what you're talking is so crazy, it's ridiculous. And that's the way it is. We need to not allow ourselves to get clean, or get dirty rather, by wallowing in the mud with others. We go back to our text at verse 7. The Bible reads, "Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened." Do we ever wonder sometime why we don't have things? Do we ever wonder that? Maybe it's because we don't ask for it. When we ask God for anything, In Jesus' name, God hears us every time. He responds in his own time and in his own way, but he hears us. You know, actually just praying in the name of Jesus actually helps us understand, and God sees that we see Jesus for who he really is. But if we truly search for God, if we truly search for him, we will find him. God is always there. He's just waiting for us to take that one step back close to him or toward him, and he will do the rest. Honestly, God is not hard to find. Just pray and read our Bibles. We will find him. We will find that he is with us all the time. In fact, if we allow him inside of ourselves, then he will always be inside of us. Forgot to switch on that one. We go back to our text at verse 9. The Bible reads, "Or which one of you, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? And if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him?" There are a lot of parents in this room. And I can speak for us parents because I'm a parent. We parents, we love our children and we will give them freely all the things that we have to give. We'll do that. Human love is not even closely compared, when you look at this, to the great love that God has given to each one of us. But when we look at it, we find that man's love is conditional. You love me, I'll love you. You don't like me, I won't like you. Whereas God's love is unconditional. He expects nothing in return. God loved us while we were yet sinners. He loved us to the point that he sent our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus, his son, to suffer and die a cruel death on the cross for our sins. He did this so that we might be saved. And when we look at all of this in comparison, it is indeed such a little thing for God to answer our prayers. So little is required of us. Just believe on the name of Jesus Christ as our Savior. We go to verse 12, and the Bible reads, "So whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Enter by the narrow gate. For the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few." Here again, we see that we should expect the same kind of treatment that we give out. If we're kind, we should expect people to be kind to us. If we're nasty, well, people will be nasty to us. But you know, giving is very much a part of receiving. But what I've seen over the years is that there are people who are very good at giving and very lousy at receiving. They're good at allowing people to give to them and allowing those people to be blessed by giving of themselves and their means. But then they don't allow people to be blessed by giving to them. And which means there are people who are awfully bad receivers. We all know how easy it is to sin. I mean, it's very easy. The world is full of sin of every kind. It's been said that a book on a bookshelf in a store may never get sold if it wasn't for the fact that it had sex and violence in it. The television set, which I don't mind, I don't have a problem with TV. I need the noise when I study, actually. But there are people who have made the television their God. Young girls today have no idea of what marriage is. Young girls today think marriage is nothing more than a long honeymoon. And where do they base this? Not on what they see at home with mom and dad. They base this on what they see on the soap operas, be it the daytime or the nighttime version. And even on shows that don't have a lot of nakedness, there's still cussing, and other kinds of sins that are imaginable. The commercial breaks bring us a satanic type of a music to sell us some products. Mind control is ardently practiced. There are even people who can tell your future. And God warns us of all these sorts of things happening. He warns us to avoid them. And sometimes we listen, sometimes we don't. But the bottom line is this: if we don't discipline ourselves, if we don't discipline ourselves and walk with Christ Jesus, then yes, we will wallow around in the mud. We will wallow around in the sin. We will wallow around on this wide road that leads to our destruction. In 1 Thessalonians, chapter 4, that whole chapter calls our attention, if you will, to godliness. It calls us to follow the narrow path rather than the wide. And we look at verse 7 of that text. And there the Bible reads, "For God has not called us for impurity, but in holiness." God does not want us to lackadaisically follow him. He wants us to come to him with pure intentions, with our eyes constantly focused on him. Steadfastly stand on the path of righteousness, which leads to life with him everlasting. We go to verse 15 of our text. The Bible reads, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves." There's never been a time in the history of mankind when there were more false prophets around than today. There are even people who are proclaiming to be our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This has been mentioned before, but it can be mentioned again. We are not to believe these people. That's the bottom line. We're not to believe them. And the reason we don't have to believe them is because when Christ Jesus does return, there will be no doubt. He will be in the sky. We will hear the trumpets. There will be no doubt. I believe Matthew 7, verse 15 that we just read, isn't just talking about false prophets. I don't think it's talking about them at all here. Because you see, the people that it was speaking to at that particular time claimed to be Christians, but they were in sheep's clothing. They were people pretending to be followers of Jesus Christ. They had an outward form of Christianity, yeah, but their hearts were wicked. Their hearts were wicked. They came to the congregation. They worked hard. They appeared to be supporting the teaching. And then, after a while, what did they do? They start dropping words here and there that cause confusion, that cause division, that cause disillusionment. They were harder to detect because than the enemy that comes at us from the outside. Why? Because they appeared to be Christians. At 2 Timothy 3, at verse 5, the Bible reads, "Having the appearance of godliness, but denying his power, avoid such people." In 2 John, the lady there was warned about deceivers. These deceivers did not believe that Jesus was God in the flesh. In the text, the Bible reads, we'll start at verse 7, we'll skip verse 8 and go to 9 and 10. But starting at verse 7, the Bible reads, "For many deceivers have gone out into the world, those who do not confess the coming of Jesus Christ in the flesh. Such a one is the deceiver and the antichrist." And as Paul puts it in another way, if you're against Christ, you're antichrist. So don't go around, don't worry about the trip sixes. Just look at the people you're talking to and pay attention to what they're saying and what they're doing. You'll know whether or not they are antichrist. Don't worry about the trip sixes. "Everyone who goes on ahead and does not abide in the teaching of Christ does not have God. Whoever abides in the teaching has both the Father and the Son. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not receive him into your house or give him any greeting. Sometimes we wonder, and I know I do, sometimes we wonder just how we can tell who is of God and who is not. Well, the first thing is this right here. Do they believe that Jesus is Emmanuel? Do they believe that Jesus is God in the flesh? Do they believe that Jesus is God with us? I mean, if they don't believe that, I mean, in the conversation, it stops right there. But people say what we want them to say. They say what they know we want to hear. So we go to number two, the second thing. What kind of fruit do they bear? What come out of the mouth does not always match the action. And so for the person that's saying, yes, 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 they would be doing something entirely different. We go back to our text in Matthew at verse 16. The Bible reads, "You will recognize them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes? Or figs from thistles? So every healthy tree bears good fruit, but the diseased tree bears bad fruit. A healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a diseased tree bear good fruit." Everyone has heard this scripture. Proverbs chapter 22 at verse 6. "Bring up a child in the way he should go. When he is old, he will not depart from it." Basically, if we teach our small children not to steal, there's a very good possibility, a very good possibility, they will never steal. And it goes for all sins. There is a group that says that, I remember when I was Catholic, and I remember something the Pope said. Give me your child at 2. By the time he or she is 5, they'll be a Catholic for life. There's a teaching in that. We start with our children here, young, to help them grow into what they should be in God's eyes later. Start early. The earlier we learn not to sin, the better off we are, the better off we will be. Not that we won't, but we understand we're not intentionally going out to do it. We are usually people. We are usually what we train ourselves to be, and we are usually what our parents have taught us to be. Environment has a great deal to do with who we become. It's kind of like a Chinese proverb. What I am, I can never change. Who I am is always changing. It is the who that God is looking for, not the what. God knows what we are, but it's the who we are that he's looking for. Who are we evolving into every day as we stay in the Word of God? Who are we evolving into every day as we are applying this to our lives each and every day? That's what God is looking for. A child who is in church several times a week would generally have better morals than a child who is never in church, or a child who is in here hardly at all, I should say. Because exposure to Christianity is very important. Cussing, swearing, telling dirty jokes, etc., are many times a habit that has been picked up at work and at school, and sadly, even in the church, unfortunately, some of it has been picked up at home. I'm not pointing fingers, I'm just speaking the truth. We can blame the world on a lot of things that's happening with our children, but sometimes we need to just go back and look at home and see what those children are seeing. Because children, when they start pointing out hypocrites, a lot of times they talk about us parents. Be mindful of that. We're all part of a family tree, every one of us. We must be careful to pattern our lives after Jesus. If we are rooted, if we are grounded in the Word of God, and if we study the Bible and hide it, hide His words rather in our hearts, then we will be able to use what knowledge we have to help others get saved. Now, some of us will be able to lead a few people to God, and some will lead hundreds. We will be fruit bearers when we work to get people saved. That's the bottom line. We always influence them. We always influence people, period, either for good or for evil. We spoke of it before. We must not judge. We must not judge, but we can be a fruit inspector, but not a judge, a fruit inspector. In verse 19, which we'll be reading in a moment, God tells us what will happen if we do not produce fruit for him. It's very much like having an orchard, right? We plant it, we wait a few years, we prune the trees, we fertilize them, we make sure we get the weeds from around them, we water them. But then if they don't produce, we cut them down. And that is what we see in verse 19 of our text. Then the Bible reads in verse 19, every tree that does not bear fruit, good fruit, is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will recognize them by their fruits. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. This is what we've been talking about. This is what we've been talking about in the church for a long time. Many people pretend to be Christians. Many people who have not sold out to God, if you will. Now, people come to church for a lot of reasons. Some come to church for the fellowship, okay? Some come for a better position in the community, okay? And some come so that they can belong to something. But you know what? When you look at these three things I just mentioned, neither one of them will get us to heaven. Neither one will get us to heaven. God wants us totally. Not at all. Planned church will not get it. Jesus explains here that, of what it takes, rather, our will must be turned over to God. It must be turned totally over to God, completely, that we be like Jesus and we can say when he was praying that morning, nevertheless, thy will be done, not mine. Thy will be done in my life. He's talking about a total commitment to God. We turn to verse 22 of our text, and the Bible reads, on that day many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And cast out demons in your name, and do many mighty works in your name, and then will I declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. The fact that they did these things was good. But why did they do them? That is the question. Was it to get great fame? Was it to make a lot of money? See, God looks more at the reasons for the things that we do. He looks for the reason more so than just the fact that we did it. God would know that we love him when he see that we are sacrificing self for him. And that's very important. We turn our attention to verse 24. The Bible reads, Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them would be like a wise man who built his house on the rock, and the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded on the rock. We must not only hear, we must also do as well. we can go to church, we can listen to what's being said, we can do this until we old and gray, but it does us no good at all until we start applying these things that we are hearing, that we have been listening to our lives. Like my granddad used to say, it's what we learn after we know everything that counts. A wise man knows the answers to life's problems. Why? Because he has searched them out in the Bible and he has applied them to his life. The rock that we must build upon is Jesus Christ. And we are told that he also is the chief cornerstone. It rains according to the word of God on the just and the unjust. Problems will come. That's what he's saying to us. Problems will come. The only difference is a Christian faces problems differently from a non-Christian, in that we pray, we ask God to help us through our problems rather than wallowing in them. Problems don't overwhelm us as Christians, because our strength is not in ourselves, because our strength is in Christ Jesus. I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. We just roll them over to his shoulders, put them on him, and he takes care of them for us. We go back to our text at verse 26. The Bible reads, "And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them would be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain fell." There's that rain again. "And the floods came, and the wind blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." It was the same problems, or the same rain, if you will. You see, without a good foundation, we fall. We must have our feet firmly planted, if you will, in the gospel of Jesus Christ. By doing that, he is able to help us withstand whatever problem we have. But at the same time, when we're having problems in this time that we're in, and it can be terrible, during those times, we can take our eyes off the problem and put them on Christ Jesus. He wants us to stand firm. He wants us to stand firm, claiming the word of God as our personal strength. He wants us to know that God is the answer. He wants us to know that there's no other way. Now, we go back to that time, that first century. The teaching that Christ Jesus was bringing forth to those people, it was very astonishing to them as they listened to him. And you know what? When we read the word of God today, it astonishes us even today with what we're seeing. He breaks with tradition. He emphatically, if you will, teaches that our hearts must be right with God and not just go through some ritual day in and day out. He seems to be interpreting the meaning of the laws of God rather than changing them. He knew and he wanted the people to understand, because we can do this today, people were blindly, systematically keeping the law without having the vaguest idea why they were keeping them. They were not truly feeling anything. They were just going through the motions. But God wants our heart. He does not want our formality. He wants our heart. And I take you to verses 28 and 29 of our text. And the Bible reads, "And when Jesus finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as scribes." Jesus didn't tell them that the law was bad. That's not why he was talking to them. He told them his interpretation of the law. And they needed to know this. He did have all authority. He wrote the law in the first place. Remember, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. He wrote the law in the first place. His understanding of the law was not earthly, but heavenly. When Jesus took on the form of flesh and dwelt here on this earth, he was able to relate to the difficulties that we have in our lives as human beings. And he was truly able to comprehend this as he comprehended the law. I believe the Sermon on the Mount is a truly in-depth explanation of what, to us rather, of what it takes for us to please God. You didn't update, did you? That's okay. Actually, I wanted something else on this slide, but it didn't get there, but that's okay. Brethren, the title for our lesson today, it was simple. Clean versus unclean. There are other ways to say this. There are many other ways to say this. The same thing. And keep in mind, whatever way we want to say it, neither is better nor worse than the other. We can say unclean, or rather clean versus unclean, saved versus unsaved, faithful versus unfaithful. But if we want to put it in perspective, we can say alive versus dead. The lesson is yours this morning. We got out a little early, but I want to thank you all for being here, and I hope and pray that we have a wonderful day. Thank you.